Oh, go on. You know you're dying to tell me about it. Go on, send me an email that tells me all about that time you ran into the Sasquatch. I want to hear all the details. Who screamed first? Who screamed the loudest? Who ran? And who ran the fastest? You know I want all the details. Go on, send that email to contact@buckeyebigfoot.com. I'll get it narrated, and then we can all hear all the details. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello, everyone. Boy, oh boy, do we have some stories tonight. You know, the kind of stories that call for serious snackage. But I'm not worried about that. I know y'all have that under control, don't you? I thought so. All right, well, let's go ahead and get down to business. We got a lot of miles to cover tonight before darkness falls. And it sure does get dark early inside Sasquatch Valley. Let's mount up and get moving. What do you say? In the 1980s, I lived in Fort Collins, Colorado. A friend's dad invited us to go hunting on his land, which was north up in Wyoming, not far from a place called the Devil's Playground. While there, we sighted a very large being. I place it at 7 feet plus tall, 350 to 400 pounds. The arms were long, muscular, and they moved front to back in wide arcs while it walked across the flat part of an open slope area. The color was very dark fur or hair covering it all over. From our position in the truck, I could see the outline of its domed head when it turned to look back at us. I could not clearly see the face, though. I recall looking towards its feet. I thought, if someone is out here pulling a joke, they will have to have some kind of shoes on. But there were no shoes that I could see. We came up on it as we drove down a dirt road. We were just driving around, killing time until we knew my friend's dad would be home. Plus, I had never been up that way, and my friend was eager to show off that whole area. This was very near the cutoff road that went up to the Devil's Playground. I recall the name well, because when I heard it, the name seemed very intriguing, but I do not recall which road we were on. I also recall we were heading east, and the road to the Devil's Playground was to the north or the right side of the road. To the left was a mostly open area of scrub and grass, and there was a tree line far back from the road. We slowed down when we saw it. We both clearly saw it walking. It turned and looked at us a couple times. My friend said to me, "Do you know what that is?" I said, "You bet I do." Our first sighting of it was approximately 30 yards from the road. When we came upon it, it appeared to be walking parallel to the road on the open grass. As we drew close, it looked at us, then abruptly changed direction and turned toward the trees off in the distance. After the second or third look back at us, it took off almost in a jog-like fashion. We were stopped on the road watching it until it reached the trees and was gone. After my friend asked me if I knew what that was, and I said, "You bet I do," we sat in the truck in total silence, watching until it disappeared. There were no cell phones then, and neither of us had a camera. Even if we had, I don't know that I would have had the mind to use either one. It was the most incredible realization to see one. I don't think I could have looked away long enough to grab a phone or a camera. For instance, I had binoculars. They were in a case at my feet in the truck floorboard, but I didn't even think to grab those. You see a creature like that, and you are mesmerized. You don't want to look away. At least, I didn't. This was a very clear day when it happened. It was mid-morning. The Bigfoot was walking through short scrub grass. I think it was September. There were no other vehicles on the road that we saw. We had only seen one other vehicle the whole time in the hour leading up to this sighting. After the creature was gone, we sat there for several more minutes. By now, I remembered I had binoculars. I got them out, and I was scanning the tree area. We were both hoping it would make another appearance, and we could see it better with binoculars. But after some time, when it didn't show itself again, we decided to drive on. When we got to his dad's house, we told him what we had seen. He said he believed it. One of his friends, who was a neighbor, we met while we were there. He was three-quarters Native American, from the Shoshone tribe. He said that area was known for Bigfoot to walk there. It's why the area next to it was called the Devil's Playground. He told us of a tale of a bunch of youngsters who had once been up there, and they saw a Bigfoot jumping from rock to rock up there, the way we children played hopscotch. And he also said that once, long, long ago, it was a meeting area for the tribes of Bigfoot, and that if you go up there even today, you will find big areas in the rock that have been cleanly hollowed out with other rocks. He said the Bigfoot tribes did that hundreds of years ago. That way, when it rained, there would always be pools of fresh water for them. I don't know if any of that is true, or maybe he was just telling us some fun stories. It was clear we were hanging on every word he said. We were only 19 and 20 at the time. Thanks for reading, Stephen. When I was younger, I used to stay the entire summer with my aunt and uncle, almost every year. I did that because my mom and dad worked all day. We lived in Waco, but my aunt and uncle, they lived west of Lufkin, Texas, out on Boggy Slough. That whole area is creepy, believe you me. Back then, my aunt and uncle had a trailer. The trailer is long gone, and I think the land has been sold. I looked at it on Google Maps. It's empty now. One summer, me and my cousins were out there. We were playing kickball out front. My one cousin kicked the ball high. It went all the way over the trailer and went almost to the trees out back. It was nearing sundown when this happened. Of course, the kicker, he scored. He passed every base and went all the way to home. My other cousin, he only half-heartedly ran to go after the ball. We all knew he had scored no matter what. There was no way my one cousin could get that ball back to tag him out before he hit home base. So, we're waiting. But after a minute, my cousin comes tearing into the trailer. He went in the back door of the trailer. We heard all of this because, with no air conditioning, all the windows were open. We could hear him. He was yelling at my aunt and uncle. They were sitting in the living room watching television. He's screaming. Something tried to grab him from the trees. He kept going on. My uncle's reply was, "Oh, horse crap." Only he didn't say crap. Then my uncle told him, "Get out of there and go run some of that fat off his belly." It's true, my cousin was fat, so that wasn't exactly wrong to say, but it was kind of mean. When my cousin came out the front of the trailer, we were waiting on him. But he had no ball. So we're like, "Where's the ball?" He said it was still back there and that he was not going to go get it. So me and my other cousin are like, "Fine, we'll go get it." But we didn't know where the ball had landed. We looked out there, but we didn't see it. So I yelled around the side of the trailer and I asked where the ball was. My cousin who went after it the first time said, "It was right there. Right there on the left side." We said, "No, it wasn't." So we said, "Come look with us and show us where it is." My cousin did not want to. But by then, my uncle had come out to see just what was going on. and together with my uncle, we all went out there. But as soon as we rounded that corner of the trailer, you could see all the way to the tree line. It was nothing but clear grass. There was no bright blue and white ball out there anywhere. We looked for a few minutes, then we gave up. We figured someone had gotten out there, and that's who scared my cousin, and they must have thought it real swell funny to take the ball. We three boys were very bummed out about it. We had pulled what little money we had to get that ball. It was in one of those big cages at the grocery store. That ball was our only real fun that summer, and we never did find that ball. My cousin swore that what tried to grab him looked like a big ape. He said he was bending down, getting ready to get the ball, and from the corner of his eye, he saw something move. He saw hairy legs, he said. He looked up, and he saw the most frightening thing that looked like a big gorilla. It must have been right by the tree, he said. He looked up, and it was starting to reach out. It was looking at him very strongly, he said. He was so scared. He said he stood up, he screamed, and he ran. He was too scared to look back to see if it was coming after him. He didn't stop until he hit the back door of the trailer. A few days after this, we are inside. The windows are still open. We turned off the TV in the room we were in because we could hear something crunching and breaking its way through all the bushes and trees out there. It's dark outside, but we're trying to look out the window anyway. We turned our light off inside. Maybe we could see, but there was still nothing we could see. Now, by the time this night happened, there were other things that had been happening all along, things that we began to notice. And we were almost starting to believe my one cousin. We thought maybe there was something like a gorilla out there that had tried to snatch him. We had laughed when he first said that. But we noticed he sure did not want to go back out back anymore. And he didn't want to leave either porch at all. I mean, yes, he was fat. But he really did eat a lot. Because really, he was the crazy active one of all of us. He was always doing things. Even when we were too tired to do anything, he was up doing stuff. He was an adventurous type, more than me or my other cousin. My point being, this wasn't like him. He wasn't trying to just sit on the porch suddenly because he was lazy. That's all I'm saying. So we were looking out the back window that night. There's no lights on the back side of the trailer, unless you turn the back light on, which was off. We couldn't see anything, but with our lights out, we thought it probably couldn't see us either. We listened, and now we heard a meowing sound. There it went again, another meow. And it sounded like a cat, but like a cat that might be hurt or hungry. It didn't sound far away either. For a moment, we discussed going out to look for that cat. We thought we could help it or at least give it some food. But my uncle had gone to the store a little bit earlier, and right then he pulled up on the gravel drive that went up that side of the trailer. His headlights hit that whole area, and we were looking out. Then we saw something in those headlights, and it looked an awful lot like a Bigfoot to me, or as my cousin called it, a big gorilla. It was standing off to the side of the trailer, maybe 20 feet away from the window where we were. The room we were in was on that end of the trailer, so we had a perfectly clear view. We all three boys screamed. We were only like 7 or 8 years old. The thing out there made a sound, like it didn't like that the light had lit it up. It suddenly moved and hid behind the tree that was there. We ran out of the room and went to meet my uncle at the front door. You see, the driveway came up that side of the trailer. Then it turned right sharply and went into a carport. But right where that gravel drive made the elbow turn to go into the carport, that was where the tree was that the Bigfoot had stepped behind. So when my uncle got out of the car, in the darkness, he didn't know it, but he was just a few feet away from it. And he had to have walked right by it in the dark. When we got to the door, we were all trying to tell him what we had seen. I don't think he believed us, even when he understood what we were trying to say. He did admit that maybe we saw an animal out there of some sort. Then we were all out there one day. My aunt and uncle were out with us too. And we all saw it. As soon as it knew that we had seen it, and it knew because my one fat cousin started pointing at it, as soon as it knew we saw it, it quickly moved back into the trees so we couldn't see it. Now, there were all kinds of sounds that summer that we'd never heard before, and none of us could explain. And there were times that things came up missing, and other times that things we would find, and we didn't know how they got there in the yard, like a neighbor's whole bag of garbage. We knew from the junk mail with the addresses on it who it belonged to. And for the record, the neighbor in question were an elderly couple. They were not the type to throw trash. That garbage bag had been ripped open, but not like an animal. It was almost in a straight line. I think something was just after whatever food was inside. True, it could have been any animal, but even my uncle noticed and had to admit that things had been pulled out like they were being sorted. Not neat piles, but you could see everything non-food had been thrown to one side, while food cans and the greasy box that had once held chicken in it, those were off to the other side. The cans were also perfectly clean inside, and all the chicken bones were missing. So, if it was bringing things to our yard, our ball was probably in someone else's yard. At least, we thought so. Weird stuff like that went on all summer. But after that summer, we never saw it again. We didn't see it again at all that summer, actually. My aunt and uncle lived there till my cousins were grown and gone. And all of them said they never saw anything, they never heard anything, and nothing weird happened ever again after that summer. Thanks for reading this. Signed, Billy the Kid. Greetings and hello to you, Nance and the Sasquatch. My name is Anson, and I would like to share my family's encounter with Bigfoot over the years. It started with my grandfather buying about 20 acres of property up near Willow Creek, California, back in 1965, after his retirement from the law profession. My grandfather wanted to get away from city life, and he wanted to spend what years he had left taking in the wonder of Mother Nature before he passed on. On his property, he kept a few milk and beef cows and a few sheep and chicken on the property. He also kept a few apple and apricot trees, plus a garden. So he had fresh fruits, eggs, milk, and vegetables. After a few years living there, he started to notice someone or something was starting to take some of the eggs, the fruit, and the vegetables while he was away, whether he was fishing, hiking, or just away visiting friends down in San Francisco. One day, back around November of 1970, while my grandfather was up there milking the cows, he heard someone walking towards the barn. Thinking it was my uncle coming to visit him, my grandfather called out my uncle's name several times, but he got no response. My grandfather stopped what he was doing and went out to see who it was. When he rounded the corner of the front of the barn, my grandfather got the biggest surprise of his life. Standing in front of him was a 7.5-foot tall, hairy being with an arrow sticking in its right thigh. My grandfather literally peed his pants. My grandmother and my uncle, they were in the house, and they looked out the window when my grandfather shouted in surprise. Both my grandmother and my uncle, upon seeing this, ran out of the house. My uncle brought with him his .30-06 rifle and a .45 caliber pistol. By the time both my uncle and grandmother got there, the Bigfoot had slumped down on the side of the barn. My grandfather, he had recovered enough from the shock of this, and he and my uncle took a closer look at the Bigfoot, and then looked at the arrow sticking out of his leg. They decided to help him, and according to both of them, it was a he. They managed to get Mr. Bigfoot into the barn. My uncle was a corpsman with the Navy and started to administer first aid. After my uncle fixed up the Bigfoot, he asked my grandfather to give him some of the antibiotics that he kept for the animals. They got a few blankets and some pillows for him, and they nursed him back to health. After about a month, the Bigfoot was well enough to leave and go back to the forest. For some time over the years, the Bigfoot would pay my grandparents a visit. My grandparents named him Clarence, after the angel in the movie, It's a Wonderful Life. Once, when I was visiting my grandparents during the summer of 1977, my grandfather took me out to a stream not far from the house to fish. We took our lunch, plus an extra one, and a peach pie. As we were fishing, my grandfather brought up the subject of the movie Star Wars, which I had seen a few weeks earlier. During that conversation, my granddad asked me if I would like to see a real-life Wookiee. I gave my granddad a whatever kind of look, and I said, Wookiees are make-believe. They're only in the movies. Granddad told me, watch and learn. He then went across a log that was lying across the stream. He took the extra lunch and the peach pie, and he set them on an old tree stump. He then came back across the stream and loudly said, Clarence, lunchtime! And then we went back to fishing. I started to hear heavy footsteps coming from the other side. I was looking around to see what was coming, and when I looked back over to the tree stump, I saw the biggest, hairiest person I have ever seen in my life. I was thinking, my granddad must have had one of his friends come help him to set up this joke on me. But at that time, that's when my uncle showed up, and he was greeting Clarence. I looked at my granddad and my uncle. I asked them both if this was for real, and they both said, yes, and they do exist. I turned around, and I beat it right back to my grandparents' house, with both my uncle and my granddad coming a few minutes later. My grandmother asked, what was wrong? And both of them told her that I had just met Clarence for the first time. It took me several years to accept the fact that this was all real. In the years since my grandparents' passing, I have gone back several times each year to leave apples and other goodies for Clarence and his family. All I ask of people who visit the Willow Creek area, or any area where Bigfoot is sighted, is to please leave them alone in peace and goodwill, and to possibly leave them some goodies. You just might get a hoot from one, or maybe a peek at one. Also, just an update. I was up there at my grandparents' place for Thanksgiving to check up on things. The resident Bigfoot family there is doing okay. Sincerely, Anson. Well, that was some trip into the valley tonight. Now, I know Anson has really been waiting for that story to be told, and I'm glad I finally could get it all pieced together for him and out there tonight. It was very important to him, so I want to say thank you, Anson, for making sure that that story got to me. I really enjoyed it. I also really enjoyed Stephen and Billy's stories as well. Thank you for sending them in. Lots of memories tonight, and all of them good. Well, as you all know, I am currently looking for more good stories for the 12 days of Squatchmas. So if you have something you'd like to hear narrated just for Squatchmas, go on, send it in, and put the word Squatchmas in the subject line. Now, I don't do the traditional timeline of the 12 days of Christmas, but I do like to help everyone get ready with a lead up to Christmas. Now, this year, I'll be starting Squatchmas on Monday, December 13th. I'll be posting a story every night right up to Christmas Eve. That's just my fun way of helping everyone have fun for the holidays. Well, I think it looks like we've all made it back safely from Sasquatch Valley. It was another good journey. I'm so glad you came along with me. Now, we'll be meeting up again real soon. But until we do, you know what's important. You always need to remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. And there'll be a lot of people who will try to convince you otherwise. You just say, nope, nothing doing. All right, everyone, thanks for listening. We'll get together again soon. Oh, hey now, hold up. You hear that grumpy Sasquatch over there? He's saying, you have not hit the like and subscribe buttons yet. Now, if that's true, I suggest you go ahead and do so. Now, don't make me turn this grumpy Sasquatch loose on you now. I mean, nobody wants that, do they?